Still waiting for a big smile out of you. You're up 2-0. What's the story? Are you not happy, or you're only half happy? Or?
Still to be happy about.
You're up 2-0.
Job's not finished. Job finished? Rick, I don't think so.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen. Two. Rick's Blazin' Takes. Could have been anywhere in the world. But you here with me. I appreciate that. So without further ado, let's get right into it.
Yeah, let's get right into it. SimWorld, what it do, what it look like. This is Rick Blaze coming to you with another episode of Blazin' Takes. And it's me. I'm recording this at nighttime, so if you hear some dogs barking in the background, it is not coming from my house. I don't have pets, but my neighbors do. So it is what it is. So I'm just saying I'm recording at nighttime. So if you hear the dogs barking in the background, excuse my neighbors. Excuse the dogs. They're not trained because my neighbors are not trained. Anyway, all right. It's Wednesday. Let's get right to it. That's not Wednesday. I can't get right to it because it's Tuesday. Okay, so by the time you got, I'm sorry. I've had a few glasses of wine. It's Tuesday for you guys. Let's get right to it. Let's have some fun right off the bat. I've said it before. I'm going to say it again Friday. Friday's a big announcement that we're making for the Blazin' Takes show. I want to have some fun. I know some of you guys mentioned you don't like waiting and the suspense is killing you. Let's have some fun. And I got to thank Coach. Is it Coach Skinny? Yeah, Coach Skinny. His new color of his logo really freaks me out. I got to thank Coach Skinny who gave me this idea. Let's have some fun. If you can guess, you put in the Discord, you get one guess per person. Media does not count. SimWorld Media does not count. SimWorld staff does not count. You can't guess and it does not count. But if you can guess what the announcement is going to be on Friday, you get one guess in the chat, in the thread. If you can guess what it is, I will DM you privately and I cash app you 25. You know what? I'm feeling good. I cash app you 50 bucks. You get one shot. You get one guess. You can guess publicly. Don't DM me all your guesses. Y'all just guess one time in the group chat. I'm not going to say if you're right or wrong because I still want to keep it a surprise. But if you are correct, I'm going to privately DM you, and we're going to sweat to secrecy, and I'm going to get your Cash App information. I'm going to cash app you $50. It's just that simple. We're starting off on a Tuesday. We're getting it down for that. So, we're going to have some fun with that. Thanks, Coach Skinny, for that idea. No, you do not get 10% unless you guess it correct. All right. So what I want to do since we have some time, since the season is over, I want to take a look back at some of the teams, all of the teams, actually, and I want to break them down. I didn't think it was fair for me to do this type of breakdown during the season because, you know, I think it could give some people some competitive advantages. So I feel like I just wanted the coaches and players to kind of figure things out on their own. But I'm going to break down the teams this past season, what their strengths, where their weaknesses were. I think I can do that now because the teams are going to look a little different. Some of them have new coaches. So what they did this season is not going to have any bearing on what they're going to do for this upcoming season. So I'm going to break them down. Now, the two champs for the Legend Conference and the Legacy Conference, I'm going to say those two for last because obviously they have less to break down. Because they were the final two, so they played the best, right? So, I'm going to start, first of all, I'm just going to go in order. Start the Legacy Conference with G5. What was great about them? They had a bunch of really good scores on the team. Most teams have one, two potentially dominant scores if you're lucky. G5 had a bunch. G5 had at least three. Now, they all didn't come to play at the same time. They all didn't ball out at the same time, but they had that potential. Like, they had three guys who potentially could just give you the business on any given night. Had they gave you the business more times than not, G5's season probably would have went a lot differently. But they had that. They were solid on the interior. So there was their strengths. The strengths were they were solid on the interior, and they had three guys who could really, really flat out score the basketball. But they did struggle in times. You know, I'm talking about Kai Anthony and Mbako. You know, those guys, they could really score the basketball. Now, their weaknesses were the same thing that was their strengths. Those guys wasn't consistent. The three scores that they had that could really fill it up were not consistent, hadn't been consistent all season long. So you got up and down, got them 5 teams. So you would see them win a big game, lose the games that they should have won, things like that, because they were really inconsistent because of the team. So that was the good side, bad side of G5. How do you beat G5 this season? You beat G5 by sticking to your script and let them shoot themselves out. That was the key to beat G5 this season. Sticking to your game plan no matter what and let them shoot themselves out, because they will shoot themselves out more often than not if you let them. All right, moving on to the other side, Legend Conference, Best Coast. Best Coast basketball, the good thing about Best, what they did best was they basically ran a 1-4 flat with LDO. They decided, hey, you know, LDO is our best player. Not only is he our best player, but I think he can get by most people on a one-on-one basis. So they flattened it out. They had the spacing and let LDO work. That's where they work best. They had a bunch of really good role players on their team, rebound, spot up shooters. So they was kind of constructed like the Philadelphia 76ers team with AI. You got one superstar and a bunch of good role players, and that was what they did very well. Each teammate played their role well. And LDO did his thing, his AI impression, very, very well as well. Now, what was hindering about Best Coast, they never got that second score. The same thing that hindered the Philadelphia 76ers. They never got that second score that can pick up the slack when LDO came out or if LDO was struggling. Also, their defense wasn't great, particularly on the perimeter. They had a pretty good interior defense, but their perimeter defense was soft. So any guard can penetrate their defense. It was looking like Jensen Street on a Friday night here in Houston, Texas. Everybody coming. So it was just one of those things where they was weak on the perimeter, and so the defense got broken down quite often, and a lot of times the front court had to make up for it. They did a lot of times, but that's a lot of pressure on the front court. So, how do you beat Best Coast? With guard play. Last season, you beat Best Coast with really good guard play. Let's try another team. Beast of the East is number 2 on the list. I'm going to skip them again because they were the champs. I'm going to go down to Run DMV. Run DMV was what was good about them, what I liked about them, what their strengths were. They didn't have one guy that would probably give you 20 points consistently every night, but they had about 3 or 4 guys that could give you 10-plus points every night. They had about 4 guys that could give you 10 to 15 points each and every night. So they was a well-balanced team, and they shot the three really well, and they was good. They had a good team speed, so you wasn't going to run them out of the gym, but you could get ran out of the gym if you wasn't ready to run with them. Run DMV was made that way. So they had really good team speed. They had really good shooters. They had about 4 to 5 guys who could score 10 points or less. Their weakness was their size. Their size with a weakness. They wasn't a particularly big team, so against really big teams or teams who really pounded in the paint, it was at a disadvantage to Run DMV. Also, they live and die by the three. I said it during their playoff run. I did not like the way that Run DMV had to win ball games, which is predominantly by the three pointer. If they were hitting them, you was in for a long night. If they was missing them, it could have easily been a blowout on the other side. So how do you beat Run DMV? Force them off the line. You want to force their shooters off the line. They're most comfortable at the three-point line, that is. You force them off the three-point line, make them take a mid-range shot. That's a little less more than what that's not really what they want to do. All right, I'll do one more on the other side. Showtime is number 2 on the list. They played a lot like Best Coast. When Bronny was there, they kind of a lot of 1-4 flat, let Bronny do his thing, let Bronny works. And 99% of the time it worked because Bronny could beat most players or any player off the dribble. So they did really good at that. Also, they were really good at team defense. Their defense was really good. They wasn't particularly quick group, but they play really good defense and they can get stops when they needed them. When you got Bronny who can shut down a guard, who can even block a guard shot or steal a ball from a guard. You also got Juka who could steal the ball from guards. And then you go down low, Jackson McLean can block the shots, and Corey Yams can block shots. Corey Yams even can play off the screen and roll and pick and roll, which a lot of bigs can't do, which made them a very good team defensively. So that was their strength. Bronny was their strength. Defense was their strength. What was their weaknesses? Well, the same thing that made them their strength was their weakness, Bronny. Because of Bronny, the coaching staff, and they went through several, but the coaching staffs never really gave anybody a chance to shine. And so I think that hindered their team. They hindered their ceiling, not giving other guys a chance to shine. They never was really. And then I would see sometimes the coach would take Bronny and Yams to be off the court at the same time. That's a terrible combination. Those were your only two consistent offensive guys, at least before Nick Moss showed up. There was no way they both should be off the court at the same time. One of those guys should always be on the court. So their rotation was kind of funky. That was a bad thing. So too much Bronny. They kind of had funky rotations at times. And when it came down to Showtime having to win it all or win a close game or win a big important game without Bronny, they hadn't had any experience doing it all season long. So they did what any team would do in the beginning of the season. If they just got together, they failed when it came clutch time because they wasn't prepared. They hadn't been doing it. So there we go. I broke those down. I broke two down from the Legend Conference. I broke two down from the Legacy Conference. I'm going to break down two more every single episode moving forward until I break down all the teams. Again, I'm saving the Beasts of the East for last, as well as Southeast Select, because those were the final two teams, which means they played the best, at least when it counted the most. So let me know what you guys think of my breakdown of these teams. I do this for real. Also, take your guess. Put your guess in the chat. You get one guess. And if you're correct, I'm going to DM you, get your information. I'm going to cash out you $50. It's just like that. Hey, I'll holler at y'all. Tamara.